everybody, I'm Nick, and in this video I'm going to show you the most important JSON Web Token or JWT setting that you have probably ignored and you shouldn't, because actually leaving this value in its default setting can actually be very problematic, and you will find out about it by the behavior looking like a bug. So in this video I'm going to explain what the setting is, how it works, why it's bad and problematic, and how you can change it to a better value. If you like that type of content and you want to see more, make sure you subscribe, and for more training check out my courses on domtrain.com. Now before I move on, I'd like to let you know that I just launched my brand new course from zero to hero logging .net on domtrain.com. Now I'm extremely proud of this because logging is such a fundamental of every .net application, no matter what type of application it is, whether that's a desktop app, an API, a web app, a game, anything can have logging in it. And it's also a cross-cutting concern, meaning that it can actually cut through any type of layers that you might have in your application. It is super important to have mastery over it, especially with modern tooling, and this course achieves that. We start from some very basics, assuming that you don't really know much about logging, into some deep dives, into some more advanced features, and then we end up covering all of the advanced features and also some high performance features. And then on top of that, because I know how important it is and how much it is used, I have a dedicated section on Serilog, a third-party library for logging that most companies out there is using, so you can have mastery over that as well. Now to celebrate the launch, I'm offering the first 400 of you a massive 20% discount code. So go at checkout and use log20 to claim a 20% discount code at your purchase. Again, that's for the first 400 of you, and they do tend to go quickly. So I hope you enjoy the course, and now back to the video. Okay, let me show you what I have here. I have two APIs here. I have this identity API and this movies API. Now the identity API is generating a JWT. It just has some logic in this controller over here that knows how to generate a JSON Web Token. And then the movies API is just a service that deals with movies. So you can create a movie, retrieve a movie, delete a movie, or update a movie. Very basic CRUD stuff. Now the way the API works is that it actually requires some Auth to make some actions. So for example, if you want to get all the movies, then you can do that. You don't really need to be authorized or authenticated. But if you want to, for example, create a movie, or if you want to delete a movie, then Auth is involved. What we're going to do is actually use this identity.api service to simulate a service that generates a token, and then we can use that token into the movies API to demonstrate the issue. Now, because I don't want to be here waiting forever and ever for things to happen, I've actually set the expiration lifetime of this token to 30 seconds. In the real world, JWT doesn't actually have such a short lifetime. It's usually, and that depends in many things, but usually what you might hear is you want your JWT to be short-lived around the 15-minute mark. That's because of how refreshing works, but that's a topic for a whole different video. For now, just know that that token that you can use to identify yourself and also interact with APIs, in this case, will live for 30 seconds. After 30 seconds, the API using that should reject it because it's no longer valid. So what I'm going to do is run this identity API in the background and show you how I can generate a token. So I'm gonna go in this token generator tab over here, and I'm just gonna say user ID, email, and then some custom claim, and I'm gonna generate my token. And the token looks like this. Now, to see what's in the token, let's go into jwt.io. So what I can do is I can actually paste my token here. And as you can see, we have a bunch of claims here in the payload section. I do have a couple of videos explaining all that in detail, so don't really worry if you don't understand everything. But if you don't understand everything, then you should watch that video first and then come back here to understand what the problem is with the JWT. I'm assuming you understand what the JWT is. And some important things here are things like the custom claim, for example, the user ID and the admin, but also things like not valid before or issued at, or expiration time, where after that time, the token is invalid. And also the not valid before means that if you try to use this token before it's actually valid, then it should also be rejected. So we have a few time sensitive things. You can see that these two values are actually 30 seconds apart, as you'd expect, because the token expiration time is 30 seconds. Now I'm going to copy the token, and I've clearly been talking for more than 30 seconds. So I'm gonna take that token and I'm gonna run the movies API and go and try to create a movie. So if I try to create the classic action comedy Nick the Greek over here, then you're going to see that if I don't use a token, I'm going to get a 401 unauthorized. But if I go to the authorization tab and I give my token as a bearer token, then this should reject it because, well, it's past the 30 seconds that this thing was actually issued at. Let's see what happens. It worked. The token, technically, I can just copy it again and prove that it's not a new token. As you can see, I'm gonna just paste it here. It expired, well, 2 minutes ago. In fact, I can just bring up the tab over here, move myself, and as you can see, this is clearly in the future, but it's still being accepted. In fact, I can copy it and use it to delete that movie as well. So what was the ID? Here we go. I'm going to copy that, and I can use that to delete it. And if I try to re-delete it, 404 not found because the resource was deleted. So the token is still valid, but it's expired. How? Well, that's behavior that many people working in .NET encounter quite often, and that has to do with something called ClockSkew. Now, the whole point of using a stateless auth mechanism like the JOT is that in distributed computing, you don't need to validate or call a database every single time to check the validity of the token, for example. All you need to do is check the signature of the token, and if that checks out, then the token must be valid and it must have been issued by a source you can trust. But also, when you have many servers, many services, this identity API could be running in some server over there, and this movies API can run in 10 servers over there, or even the same for the identity API, it could be scaled out as well, then you could have a situation where, yes, we can try to synchronize the clocks using the network, but sometimes the machines can have different times. That causes a situation where the token could technically still be valid, but because there's a bit of a drift on the time on the server, just a small amount, not a big amount, then you still want that token to be perceived as valid. And that's called ClockSkew. Now, ClockSkew is something that happens on the consuming side of things. So the service accepting a token will actually dictate how much the ClockSkew will be. So if I actually go into the program.cs and then the auth settings, as you can see over here, we have the token validation parameters. Now we have some things related to the key, the valid issuer, the valid audience, things you'd expect, but we also have the clock skew setting. Now here's the funny story about the clock skew setting. Do you know what the default value of it is? Well, let's take a look. I can go here and we can take a look at the clock skew, and the default clock skew is 5 minutes. Meaning that in a token that is supposed to be short-lived, let's say 15 minutes, well, in reality, it is 20 minutes because you have this much of a clock skew by default. And generally, that is a very, very high clock skew. I don't know why it is that high. I do know that this library has been around for a long time. So this kind of means that if they set it to some value back in the day, they kind of have to keep it that way. Otherwise, it is a very big breaking change. However, this is a setting you should override pretty much always. Now, by how much? Well, that's heavily debated, but generally people agree between 5 and 30 seconds. 30 seconds is actually pushing it. I think Akamai, the computing edge cloud service, actually recommends 5 seconds, because any clock skew over 5 seconds on a network synchronized machine, which all of them should be, actually indicates a different problem with the machine itself. So that's why you should not have it more than, I don't know, I would say 15 seconds, let's say worst case scenario, because it can actually hide another issue. 5 minutes is ridiculous. Now, let's go back here and change this to a time span from seconds, and let's say 5, and try to do the exact same thing. So what I'm going to do is stop the movies API and just rerun it over here. So now I'm going to just generate another token over here, token generated, and I'm going to go to create movie. Now I'm going to have to wait for 30 seconds. Yes, if I try to create the movie now, it will work. As you can see, movie was created. And if I try to delete that movie, I can get that over here and I can just paste it and delete it. However, let's just wait for 30 seconds. For you, it's going to be just a quick edit. For me, it's going to be at least 10 more seconds. Okay, that should be it. So I'm going to go and try and recreate that movie again. And as you can see, 401 unauthorized. If that was the default value, I would still be able to use it for another 5 minutes. But you have to understand that any time related things actually go both ways with the clock skew, meaning that not only it will expire 5 minutes later, but it will also be valid 5 minutes earlier. Because remember, we do have that other value in the token called not valid before. And just to prove that, what I'm going to do is comment the clock skew out to show you that the default value is 5 minutes. And then I'm going to go to the token security description over here, and I'm going to say not before daytime UTC now. And I'm going to add in this scenario at 1 minute. So I'm going to say this will not be valid until 1 minute in the future. Now, for this to actually work, because the not before time cannot be after the expiration time, I'm going to have to increase the expiration time to, let's say, 2 minutes. And once I do that, I should be able to just run the identity API and the movies API and go ahead and generate a token over here, copy it, and try to create a movie. Now, this token should be invalid. It should only be valid in a minute in the future. But if I try to call this API, as you can see, it works because the ClockSkew by default is 5, meaning, well, you have basically an extra 10 minutes by default where the token is valid. You should not ignore this setting. This is something you should actually change, of course, depending on the context of your situation. But in any context, 5 minutes is insane. There's been countless Stack Overflow posts about this because it actually does look like unexpected behavior. It does look like a bug. So take the setting into your own hands. If you're validating something like this, lower the ClockSkew. It will actually make your systems implicitly more secure as well. But now I want to know from you, did you know that this is the setting I was going to talk about? And what's the value you are setting for your systems? Leave a comment down below and let me know. Well, that's all I had for you for this video. Thank you very much for watching. And as always, keep coding.